Copperbelt Life, my dad's collection reel of all the bits that didn't fit elsewhere. First of all, the Queen Mother's visit to Luanshya. They got the town nicely spruced up for her. Flags and bunting everywhere. Whitewashing the oil drums to mark the roads. And a nice new archway over the entrance to town. Our house was just to the right of that archway. There's still an archway there, but not that one. There's a nicer one now. Here are all the school children in their uniforms, showing up with British flags to wave. Various dignitaries from the different communities that lived in Luanshya. And here come the cars, and the longest and swishiest car is the one that the Queen Mother is in. A Daimler, that one. And there she comes. The mayor is greeting her, the Lord Mayor of Luanshya, and various other officials, judges, and so forth. This is being held at the grounds of Luanshya Primary School, the school I was attending at the time. So people are being brought and presented to her, and they each show her courtesy according to the customs of their community. And the motorcade continues on down one of the main roads in Luanshya. Now we've cut to school sports day, and this is it, the egg and spoon race. Now they have to go pick up a potato, put it in the bucket, run back and get another potato, put it in the bucket, gradually fill the bucket up. Here's a couple of high jumpers, in skirts even. Those were the days. Here's the next potato race. And this would be me, dressing half and half. One side long, one side short, different socks, different shoes. And you notice I've got my belongings thrown in the traditional bundle, tied to a stick over my shoulder, and I'm going to leave home. That's the plan here anyway. So past the sand pit my dad built for me to play in, and over the front yard, and I'm off. And this is where I wave to everybody saying, goodbye, I'm not coming back. And I take off. Here's another one of me, this time in drag, we'd call it today. And I think that was for a party next door. And then we're at Ndole Airport. And in those days, the tarmac was quite open and you could walk right up to the planes at any time. Life was different at that time. Then the camera club. You'll see a lot of cameras in this next scenes because the camera club organized an outing to the blind school so they could get pictures of the work that's done there. They were able to do their various kinds of work by feel, by knowing where things were. So I believe they're doing laundry here. And there we have Bolex 16mm movie camera and I think a couple of stills there. The soccer ball has pebbles inside it so that you can hear it rolling along the ground. And that's how they're able to kick it. Three blind girls walking in perfect sync. Now they're playing cricket, but using that noisy soccer ball. A modified form of cricket for the blind. And even some sports. High jump. Not very far away from that, there's a feature called the Sunken Lakes area where people would go on picnics. There are three lakes. They're steep-sided and the conical shape keeps going down to the bottom. So they're quite deep in the middle. And they're believed to be connected together because they all rise and fall together. Could be just going up and down with the water table. The Sunken Lakes area was considered a beauty spot and people would go there to have a picnic. Here's a car seat has been removed and propped up against a tree so that we can have our picnic in comfort. And I believe we were with our next door neighbors because I think that might be Lynn Marsh who just walked by. That would be my mom under the tree. And then we have, the kids were playing their own game somewhere. And I believe Mom saw a picture on one of these scenes here. She saw a pathway that leads to the water level. There it is. So it is possible to walk right down to the water. Now the grass houses were the oldest houses in Luanshya, and they were built out of mud brick and then a grass roof. The grass roofs are still there, but they were topped with a sheet iron roof afterward. So they left the grass in as insulation. And that's they were the old houses. They didn't have built-in toilets, so there were honey buckets out in the backyard there. And they were collected once or twice a week. An old Ford Anglia or Ford Popular. That one's even older than the one in Harry Potter. And then we have some of the well-known trees of Africa. That was jacaranda. If you look at modern pictures of it, the purple color comes out so much better with current photographic technique. The films those days just couldn't capture the true beautiful purple color. That one's probably hibiscus. I really don't know. I'm not much on plants. That's poinsettia. This is how it looks in Africa, and it gets bigger than that. It's not just a little potted plant that you see at Christmas time. I see there's some insects in there too. Here they go. Going out into the bush. In this case, we're going to collect bamboo. Bamboo grows wild, it grows fast. If there ever was a renewable resource, it's bamboo. So that would be our gardener and myself. He's cutting them down. I'm trimming them. Well, I think my father does it a lot quicker and more efficiently than I do. We're collecting these to use in our garden for fencing. It's not a time to go home, I guess. We've loaded the truck. We would just sometimes drive out there where there were no roads, just make our own path through the flat bush and set up a chair and have a picnic. So my mom's brought the paper. Those are our two dogs. The golden one is Ranger and the dark one is Timmy. You'll see more of Timmy later. My dad took this one to show how fast they eat the leaves. And here we are with the full canopy on the back of the pickup and heading back toward our home. Who needs a road? Better stop soon. We're heading off to get some more of that bamboo. Perhaps we're a different location this time, because I believe there's a hill involved here. My dad has a large panga in his hand there. So here's our day's work. Okay, there's one. Couldn't break that thing. Looked like it should be easy. Finally, I got it broken. And here he is cleaning up the sticks. This is not bamboo, is it? Not sure. Too many leaves. But whatever it is, it's going to be used around the garden. If you went back there today, you'd probably find most of the large trees are gone. They've been turned into charcoal at some point and burned. Here we are pretending. That is Colin. He belongs to one of our friends. Was staying with us for a while. That is a very small baby chameleon. Exploring my mom. That would be our gardener busy mowing the lawn. In the background, you see what happened to some of those sticks. My dad used them to grow beans on. Now we've found ourselves a place where there's some running water coming out of the rock. It's an opportunity to wash our hands. This is Armistice Day, November 11th, and the local parade at the cenotaph in Luanshya. A lot of people growing up in Luanshya don't even know what a cenotaph is and why it's there. They think it's a grave of somebody. But everybody knew in our day. Here we are, the scouts. I'm in the Sea Scout troop here. Look for me, see me. And scouts would all line up and all the ex-servicemen wearing their medals, current servicemen in uniform, and pay their respects to the dead. And it's usually a parade. My dad would have been in that group. Except I think he's the one taking the movies. So that particular year, he probably wasn't marching. still wearing my Sea Scout uniform, and I'm playing with Timmy in the backyard. He liked to tease. He'd make you run after him. The Kafuba River was south of town, and it's where we got our drinking water from. And the pumping station was a favorite place to go and fish. My dad would actually get assigned to go there from time to time because the person who lived on site and looked after it 24 hours a day had to take a day off to go shop in town. So then they'd assign somebody else to cover for him for the day. Here I am getting ready to cast my net, my fishing line. You're not allowed to swim there because the disease bilharzia is found in that water. That would be the gentleman we were relieving for the day. RACM would be Roan Antelope Copper Mines. So in this building they had three large pumps that pumped water to the town, and the gentleman that lived there had the benefit of the highest water pressure anybody got anywhere and used it to advantage to water his personal private garden. He couldn't drink the water himself because the water purification plant was 5 miles downstream from there, so he had to use a filter. That would be Lynn, I'm sure, and our next door neighbor. And we're with Timmy and Ranger. Ranger being still quite young there. So, and even though we're not supposed to swim there, I see we're paddling in it. Now, downstream of the weir, it was a bit of a challenge to see if you could walk all the way across on those rocks. You had to do it barefoot, and the rocks were loose. And of course, the rule against swimming didn't apply to dogs. But notice Timmy doesn't mind going out to retrieve the stick. But Ranger is too timid to go and get wet. So he hangs around by the shore. However, he wants to take credit for it when Timmy gets back with the stick. He wants to hang on to it too. The only thing is, Timmy's holding too short an end for him to grab onto there. Won't let him take credit. Funny. And there's Timmy. He really could hold on tight. That was his favorite game to play. He liked to hang on. You could even lift him quite high up in the air. And he was happy with that. I'm not sure what I'm dragging in the water there, but Timmy's having fun going after it. Here's our car getting its twice a year polish or whatever it was. Gardener showing off his prowess here. He is, I see he's brought the mower with him. I'm not sure what he thought he'd mow at the car. Here's a bird that I think took a dislike to its own reflection in the hubcap. Every now and then he jumps up and pecks at it. There. He wants to know where the other birds come from, where they go to. These were the Van Ryans, friends of my parents, who later moved to Durban. And Timmy's in playful mood again. I get to hold him up really high. Look at that. Luanshya. The main entrance to town, our house being on the right, Still running around the backyard with Timmy here. Right behind Timmy, that would be my dad's Rainbird garden watering device. Watering the entire lawn from one position there. Saying goodbye to friends as they fly off. I'm not sure if they're going to England or to South Africa. Those are the two popular destinations, but they're leaving from Ndola Airport. Very small plane by today's standards. I noticed the windsock was full there, so quite strong winds that day. You can tell from the hair too. So Macomber Dam, which I think you might have seen in other movies, but this is the hydroplane racing. There were two kinds of boaters out on the lake. Those who raced power boats and those who liked to do sailboats. So they each had their designated days and times when they could indulge their sport. The power boaters were noisy as could be and had a lot of fun doing this. They're out there every weekend. Spectators are on the floating jetty. I wonder how fast they really do go. I don't know. Well, that looks awfully fast. This would be the time when we first moved into 12 O Avenue. We had to get the lawns cut because they hadn't been cut for some time. We hired three or four people to come and hack them down with the swinging scythes. We called them slashers. And here's the road getting graded outside the front of our house. So O Avenue was a gravel road. The tree marks the edge of the garden for our place, although I think we could have had more if we'd wanted to. The previous tenants had decided that was as far as they were willing to garden it. We were at the end of a triangular patch of land there, and they'd stopped there. We had a nice circle to run our cars around, so we didn't have to back up ever. And here we are. My dad's room was in the background. He worked shifts, so he had the room that had been cut off from the end of the veranda. in the right season of the year, you could get clouds like this. And then in another season, you could get no clouds at all for months on end. The garden hut there, we call it a gazebo here, had a thatched roof when we came in, but it didn't last. And then we replaced it with a tin one. And that's our front yard. Although nobody ever came to the front door, everybody came to the back door. Still playing with Timmy. That would be my mom playing with Timmy there. That's our front door. That'd be the side of the house as you see it from the road. Front door to the left, back door to the right. And then our garage, separate from the house, with a lean-to shelter for a second car. And flower beds everywhere. This would be the back door, and it's hard to see, but there's a peach tree there in front of the last window. In the green area, that's where my dad planted his garden, and very young banana trees. They got so much bigger than that later. And that was the kaya, as we called it, which just means a room or house. It's where your servants lived. That would be a pawpaw tree. Look at the number of pawpaws on that tree. We had several trees. So we grew around bananas, lemons, and pawpaws. Taffy was our last dog that we had. So there he is with Timmy, and he's a puppy here. Little tiny puppy, little did you know how big he'd grow. Because Taffy's parents were a Great Dane and a Rhodesian Ridgeback. When his temper got up, you could see the ridge down his back. The rest of the time it was sort of hidden, more or less. He was called Taffy because, well, it's a typical name for a Welshman, and my parents were both from Wales. That's the dog who, here, he's already grown up some. And he's the dog who ate a pound of steak every day and drank a Pepsi at night, along with cornmeal porridge, which we called sadza, that had been flavored with things like bacon rinds to make it meaty. Taffy got the stick this time. Suddenly aware of the camera. At this point they were playing, but later on it got rough and Timmy was quite quite dangerous to taffy. So Timmy had to go, unfortunately. The peach tree outside the window of our house. We actually had two of them. The peaches weren't very good. They never got soft. They weren't very sweet either. Birds seemed to do better at them than we did ever. That's more like the taffy I remember. Taffy was big enough with long enough limbs that he could, if he stood up fully on his hind legs and stretched his front legs out, he could put his paws on your shoulders and look you in the eye. You will see him almost reach his full height in some of these scenes. I'm not sure why he's doing it. Looks like he's having fun then. Now you see what I mean. Yeah. I've often said that when I went off to boarding school, Taffy took my place in the house. Member of the family. If you were watching too much TV, he'd come and stand between you and the TV set. I think he's going to take some food right out of my dad's mouth here. There you go. Not sure why he's tiptoeing through the daisies. And that was Taffy.